field-by-field manure nutrient management program requires multiple components to maintain adequate fertility for crop growth and development while minimizing soil and water quality impacts. A well-designed soil sampling plan, including proper soil test interpretations, along with manure sampling, manure nutrient analysis, equipment calibration, appropriate application rates, timing, and application methods are all necessary components of a manure nutrient management plan. Implementing these components allows manure to be recognized and used as a credible nutrient resource, potentially reducing input costs and minimizing environmental impacts. This video will cover three of these components: manure sampling, manure nutrient analysis, and field application methods. This segment will demonstrate the procedure for taking a liquid dip sample. Sampling manure prior to application will ensure that you receive the analysis in time to adjust nutrient application rates based on the nutrient concentration of the manure. Be sure to label sample bottles before filling them with the manure sample. A few pieces of equipment are needed for manure sampling. First, rubber gloves to protect yourself, a bucket to mix the subsamples from different locations in the pit, a funnel to pour the final mixed sample into, the labeled sample bottle, and a dip sampler. This sampler was made using a long piece of 1x2 and a cup securely taped to the end. When getting a sample, you need to have access to the pit, often through the pump out ports. Once the port is open, break through the crust that may have formed on the surface and stir in one area to obtain a uniform sample. Taking one sample is similar to taking one soil core when soil sampling, so it is necessary to take three subsamples from within each pump out port. After three subsamples have been taken from one port, move on to all remaining ports and access locations, repeating the process of mixing and taking three subsamples. After subsamples are collected, stir or swirl the bucket to mix the subsamples. Using the funnel, pour the mixed sample into the bottle until the bottle is about 3/4 full. The sample may be frozen before sending to the lab, so the extra space is needed for expansion. The sample should be frozen immediately and shipped frozen on a Monday or Tuesday, so it arrives at the lab for analysis during the week and not during the weekend. This method will adequately reflect the nitrogen content of the pit, but will not be a good representation of the phosphorus concentration in the manure source, as phosphorus tends to be found in the solids that can settle to the bottom of the storage structure. Another way to take a liquid manure sample is to use a core sampler. The core sampler allows you to obtain a sample that best represents the manure from top to bottom throughout the pit, capturing any stratification, especially with phosphorus. The sampler is made using 1.5-inch PVC pipe with a tennis ball attached to a rope that plugs the end after taking a sample. There are commercial samplers that can be used also. To take a sample, release the plug and run the pipe down into the manure all the way to the bottom, then pull the plug tight. You should only sample from the solids at the bottom of the storage structure if, in fact, those solids will be completely agitated and removed from the structure. Take the sampler over to the sample bucket and release the plug, emptying the sample into the bucket. Taking one sample is similar to taking one soil core when soil sampling, so it is necessary to take subsamples from at least three locations within each pump out port. After three subsamples have been taken from one port, move on to all remaining ports and access locations, repeating the process of mixing and taking three subsamples. After samples are collected, stir or swirl the bucket around to mix the subsamples. Next, using the funnel, pour the mixed sample into the labeled bottle until the bottle is about 3/4 full. The sample may be frozen before sending to the lab, so the extra space is needed for expansion. The sample should be frozen immediately and shipped frozen on a Monday or Tuesday so it arrives at the lab for analysis during the week and not during the weekend. To get a representative sample from an open feedlot, it is important to take a subsample at several locations around the lot. Before you begin, label the sample bag with the location, date, and sample number. Scrape a shovel across the concrete, then mix the manure thoroughly. Take a small subsample from the mixed manure and transfer it to a bucket. Repeat this process at 10 or more locations from around the lot, making sure to mix the sample each time before taking a subsample and adding it to the bucket. Mix the subsamples that have been added to the bucket, and using a rubber glove or with your hand inside the plastic sample bag, grab a sample from the bucket to fill the plastic bag. When sampling composted manure, as with all manure sampling, it is important to get a sample that is representative of all manure that will be applied. There are several ways to obtain a representative sample from composted manure, and two we will feature are drilling and a profile sample. Before you begin, label the sample bag with the location, date, and sample number. Using a drill with a core sampler attached, drill into the composted manure to the depth of the sampler. Remove the manure from the sampler using a dowel or small piece of pipe and empty it into the sample bucket. Repeat this process at 10 or more locations from around the pile to obtain a representative sample, emptying the core sampler into the sample bucket each time. Mix the subsamples that have been added to the bucket, and using a rubber glove or with your hand inside the plastic sample bag, grab a sample from the bucket to fill the plastic bag. Another method that can be used to take a representative sample from composted manure is to move a portion of the pile with a skid loader to expose a profile of the pile. Before you begin sampling, label the sample bag with the location, date, and sample number. Using rubber gloves or with your hand inside a sample bag, take samples from several locations from the top of the pile to the bottom, placing each subsample in the bucket. When at least 10 samples have been taken, thoroughly mix the sample and using rubber gloves or the sample bag, grab a subsample to fill the sample bag. When the manure analysis report returns from the lab, it is important to spend time reviewing the information to determine how this might affect your nutrient applications. First, compare this report to other samples collected from similar facilities with similar management practices to determine if something might be odd about this sample. If so, you may consider having the lab redo the sample. Next, the most important parts of the lab report will be looking at the total nitrogen, or N, or total keldal nitrogen, TKN, ammonium N, the phosphorus, usually expressed as P2O5, and potassium, expressed as K2O. Total N, or TKN, represents the total amount of organic and inorganic in the manure sample. It does not tell you what is immediately available for plant use, nor does it reflect losses from handling or application. Ammonium N, or NH4N, represents the main inorganic N fraction, or immediately available plant N. The greater the percentage of ammonium N, the greater the amount of N available for immediate plant use. Phosphorus can be expressed as total P, or as P2O5, as in this example. If the lab report you receive is expressed as total P, you should convert to P2O5 by multiplying P by 2.29 to equal P2O5. This makes it easier to compare to commercial fertilizer sources. Potassium can be expressed as total K or K2O. To convert K to K2O, multiply K by 1.2. Labs may also report percent solids or percent moisture, pH, and micronutrients, but the NPK values are usually the nutrients of most interest for crop production. How do we use this information to calculate a manure application rate? For example, if we want to apply 150 pounds of N per acre for our corn crop, if we divide the 150 pounds per acre by the total N found in this sample, 57.5 pounds per 1,000 gallons, we get 2.6 or 2,600 gallons per acre. We can do a similar calculation to determine the phosphorus application rate. Manure has a lot of valuable nutrients. A producer needs to know the quantity of manure available, the nutrient analysis of the manure, the crop needs, the current soil test results, and the handling and application costs. Use of manure may result in increased or decreased yields when compared to traditional fertilizers, depending on any of a number of reasons. Crop producers need to predict how well they can manage manure as a fertilizer source and what the overall impact will be over a number of years. If they can, they will be better able to determine the value of the manure in their farming operations. The most common method of valuing fertilizer is component pricing. The manure is sampled and tested to determine the nutrient content. Then this analysis is used to determine the value based on commercial fertilizer prices. Another method to price manure is to price it as a bulk commodity, where you have sellers and buyers. If you are in an area that has an abundance of supply and limited demand, it will drive the price down. If demand outstrips supply, the price will increase until it balances out with the demand. The nutrients would have a different value depending on the location and local situation. Transportation and distribution costs become a factor in negotiating a price. If there is an overabundance of manure in one area, and the livestock producers are faced with high transportation costs to move it out of the area, they may be willing to reduce the price if they can avoid significant transportation costs. After the manure samples have been taken using the proper methods and analysis results are available, the application rates can be calculated according to crop needs and environmental risk. One strategy for reducing the risk of nutrient loss is using low disturbance injection equipment. Low disturbance application leaves a higher level of residue on the soil surface, protecting the soil from erosion and nutrient loss. We will view several types of application equipment that leave various levels of residue after incorporation or injection. This video was taken at a field day at the Iowa State University Southeast Research Farm in September 2010. Four different injection and incorporation systems were reviewed side by side, injecting water into soybean stubble. Manure application equipment can play a crucial role in getting the right rate in the right place. Many times we give consideration to getting manure on as fast as possible without much consideration to the amount of soil disturbance that occurs and can potentially lead to soil erosion. Some systems can also leave more manure on the surface, thereby causing an increased potential of volatile losses of N or runoff of nutrients. Producers should consider using the piece of equipment that best matches their objectives and should demand the same from their commercial manure applicator. Systems that inject manure below the soil surface with minimal soil disturbance would be ideal. The first system is a FarmStar injector with drag hose system. The unit has Dietrich 8-inch flat sweeps and has a 2,000 to 25,000 gallon application range. The second system is a Hool 7300 with a Soil Warrior manure system. The unit has fluted coulter disc covers. This unit performs zone tillage close to the hub. The third system is a Hool 6000 with fixed disc covers. This unit has adjustable down pressure and depth. The fourth system is a GEA FarmTech Hool 7300 with a 7-row Dietrich toolbar and Dietrich Series 70 no-till units. From left to right, the first four are without sealers and the last three include sealers with 22.5-inch gauge wheel coulters. Flow control regulates rate at variable speeds.
We have discussed the manure sampling, analysis, and application components of a manure nutrient management program. It is important to review your current program to make sure that manure nutrients are being properly accounted for. Accurate application rates and proper timing ensure that manure nutrients are adequate for crop growth and reduce the risk of overapplication that could lead to negative impacts on water quality. Utilizing low disturbance equipment can improve the quality of your soil by leaving a higher level of residue on the soil surface. Residue protects the soil from erosion, which keeps nutrients in the field where they are needed for crop growth. Fine-tuning your application rates, methods, and timing can potentially reduce your input costs while maintaining crop yields. A well-thought-out manure nutrient management program also can keep excess nutrients and sediment out of our rivers, streams, and lakes.